Keeping us as your sons and daughters. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And good morning to you who are joining us online, and good morning to our deaf friends who are with us this morning. Happy New Year. In the calendar sense, it's good to be back. It's nice to get away, and so it's nice to come home. I don't know if you guys had, actually some of you I know had the chance to travel. Our travels landed us in Florida, where I got some much-needed rest, because I was sick the whole week. But, you know, the Lord provides, right? The Lord provides, and so it's good. It's good to be back. Couple of things before we get started. In the seat back in front of you, there's a white card. Please take a moment and fill that out, and then place it in one of the trays toward the back. Members, you kind of know what to do with it. If you're a guest this morning, we are grateful that you're here with us, and we'd love to learn more about you. So please, anything that you would like to share with us, we would like to know. So take a moment to do that. Also, too, this being the first Sunday of the month, the order of worship is divine service, too. We had a little bit of a complication in getting the music for the sung parts of the liturgy to project. And so if you don't mind, in the seat back or under the seat in front of you should be a hymnal. Oh, it's also in the bulletin. For those of you who have a paper bulletin, it's in the bulletin. But if you don't have one of those, just grab it out of the book, and the book is in the seat back in front of you. Some of you probably know the music by heart, but I will walk you through that. When we get to that part, we'll start, the liturgy starts on page 168, and I'll give you another reminder for that, but just know that that's going to be a part of our worship this morning. All right. As we gather for worship, we begin a new season in the church year, the season of Epiphany, following Advent, hope, and Christmas joy in the Savior born for us. We enter the season of Epiphany, which can be summed up with words such as revealing and shining forth, manifestation. The word that we hear today is fitting, as Epiphanies are things that the Lord has done since the beginning of time. The first creation was light shining forth on that first day. From that day of creation to the fall into sin, to the first promise of the Savior, God has shown his light and enabled his people to see and know what is needed. As the time was right for Jesus to begin his earthly ministry, it began with his baptism. With John the Baptist in the Jordan River, the Lord reveals and shines forth the manifestation of the Word made flesh for us when he says, "You are my beloved Son, with you I am well pleased." So let's begin our worship this morning with our opening hymn, "Thy Strong Word." Let's rise for that.
Thank you.
Friends in Christ, God has called us to worship this morning, and so we begin in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
On this Sunday, as we begin the season of Epiphany and focus on the baptism of Jesus, baptism in the Scriptures is the great exchange point where we receive Christ's righteousness and He receives our sin. And we remember our baptism with this Trinitarian invocation, recalling and confessing before heaven, earth, and hell all that God has given us in our baptism. Victory over death and the devil, forgiveness of sin, God's grace, the entire Christ, and the Holy Spirit with His gifts. And so how do we rightly use our baptism? When Jesus was baptized by John in the water of the Jordan River, the Father declared Jesus as His Son, with whom He was well pleased. In our baptism, Paul wrote that we were joined to our Lord's death and resurrection, enabling us to walk in newness of life. And we also learn in the small catechism, all centered on God's Word, the lasting gifts received in baptism, including the forgiveness of sins, rescue from death and the devil, and eternal life to all who believe this. Let us reaffirm our faith in what God has done for us through holy baptism. Friends in Christ, do you renounce the devil and all his works and all his ways?
I do renounce.
Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth?
Yes, I believe.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried, who descended into hell the third day and rose again from the dead, who ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He will come to judge the living and the dead.
Yes, I believe.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting?
Yes, I believe.
Friends in Christ, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean, for we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your presence and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Friends in Christ, I have good news for you. Almighty God, in His mercy, has given His Son to die for you, and for His sake, He forgives you all of your sins. And as a called and ordained servant of Christ and by His authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. We continue with the Kyrie on page 168, if you have your hymnal there. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all
worship and praise. Let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King,
Jesus, in the Jordan River, you proclaimed him your beloved Son and anointed him with the Holy Spirit. Make all who are baptized in his name faithful in their calling as your children and inheritors with him of everlasting life. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Congregation, please be seated. We continue with the Old Testament lesson this morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The Old Testament reading this morning is from Genesis 1, chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. The epistle lesson is from Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 11. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who have died in sin still live in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. For one who has died has been set free from sin. Now, if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death he died to sin, once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you must also consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Out of honor for Jesus, who is the Christ, we rise for the reading of the gospel. Baptizing in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the country of Judea and all Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist and a locust and wild honey. And he preached, saying, "After me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my beloved Son, with you I am well pleased." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We continue with the sermon hymn, Songs of Thankfulness and Praise. Congregation, please be seated. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, for indeed you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. As we embark on this season of Epiphany, a new season in the church year, we find ourselves in the Gospel of Mark this year. Each week, as God's people, we come to this place to be shaped and molded by his word and worship, and we focus on a couple of things throughout the year. The first half of the church year is really focused on the life of Christ and his ministry, what he has done for you and I to make us his children. The second half of the year is spent on the life of the church and our response to God's grace and what that looks like in the world in which we live. And each year we focus on different biblical texts around those themes, and it offers us a greater opportunity to get through more of Scripture because we use a three-year lectionary. And all of this is, I guess, inside baseball, but just to give you an idea. This year we get into the Gospel of Mark. And Mark is the shortest of the four Gospels, and I mention this for two reasons. Number one, it's a good book to read through and read through often. It doesn't take too long to get through it. If one of your New Year's resolutions is to read a Gospel frequently. Mark is a good candidate. But there's that. And Mark is quick. He gets to the point. I think that's another good reason to spend time in Mark. Mark is an action gospel. He doesn't spend much of time at all talking about Jesus's birth or his childhood or the genealogies or anything like that. He jumps right to one of the most important points of Jesus's life, and certainly yours and mine, baptism. John the Baptist in the Jordan doing something new, a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, something that had never been done before, at least not in the scriptures, right? And we encountered this text just a few weeks ago in the second Sunday of Advent. One of the standout aspects of this passage is the fact that John the Baptist, again, for the first time, is calling people to repent and actually washing their sins away. Baptism has not been used this way in the scriptures before. For centuries, offerings and sacrifices were given for sins committed, but never before could you go to a river, confess your sins, turn from them, and have them washed away. All of this is designed to pave the way, so to speak, for our Lord Jesus as he's about to begin his ministry. Now, there's a lot that could be said about baptism. After all, it is one of the most significant marks of Christianity, because we believe, we teach, and we confess that it is necessary for salvation. Baptism saves us, St. Peter says. Baptism joins us to the family of God. It grafts us into Christ, who is the vine. St. Paul says in Galatians 3, he talks about being clothed with Christ in our baptism. And it's important for us to remember this, because baptism is not done by us. It's done to us. It's done by someone outside of us. And it's done under the direction, command, in the presence of God, which is why we focus on baptism as a sacrament done by the hand of God. I mentioned this before. It is the great exchange point where Jesus picks up our sin, places it on his own shoulders, and carries it to the cross of Calvary to pay for it once and for all. In that same event, that same baptism, we are clothed with Christ, his righteousness. We gain the identity as a child of God, forgiven of all of our sins. But there's one other thing that comes out here in our gospel text, and it's easy for us to skip over it and maybe even overlook it. In verse 10, there is a two-letter word, he. The he in verse 10, it refers to Jesus. Jesus came from Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And when he, Jesus, came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens opening and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. According to Mark, no one seems to know what's going on except Jesus. How often do we look at what's going on in our lives and know what it is? How often do we see what's going on in our world and know exactly what that is? Walk away with complete understanding. Not very often. There's always more to know. There's always more to understand. We don't have a definitive, exhaustive grasp on everything. But Jesus does. We even have a term to describe this. Lord only knows what's going on here. Right? It's true. It's also true that the Lord knows what's going on. One of the aspects of Christianity is that Christians tend to squabble over from time to time this issue of baptism of the Holy Spirit connected with baptism by water. Obviously, when we baptize in this place, we see a child at the font or an adult at the font, and we see the water that's poured or sprinkled on their forehead, and we can hear the water as it falls back into the font. But at the same time, because we believe what the Scripture says about baptism, we know that the baptism we see by the hand of the pastor is at the same time a baptism of the Holy Spirit performed by God. It's done under His command with His blessing. But wait a minute. Who saw in baptism? You guys have all seen a baptism. Have you ever seen the Holy Spirit descend and enter that person being baptized? But Jesus does. Jesus does. And there are a lot of things that we may or may not know, but Jesus knows. And that's what's important. Jesus knows you. Jesus knows every baptismal candidate, whether it be a child or an adult. Jesus knows. It's important for us to know God. I don't want to diminish that. But the most important thing is Jesus knowing us. And Jesus knows. At what point, how it works, all the facets of baptism, we don't know for sure until we enter into the presence of God when Christ comes again. It's a mystery, as the Scriptures say. But we don't need to specifically see the Holy Spirit baptizing a person to know that they are baptized. Because Jesus sees them. And Jesus knows. God has given us His promises establishing baptism, and we put our faith in His Word. His Word that promises that you and I are made new. His Word that promises that you and I are born again in that water. Not of perishable seed, but of imperishable seed, with a new identity. And one of the things that Mark tends to focus on, and it comes out here, is the fact that regardless of our ability to see and understand what is going on concerning the kingdom of God, it comes to us. Independent of our grasp of God's love for us, and our ability to understand the depth of His forgiveness. We have it. And that's what St. Paul is getting at when he writes in Romans 6. We know that grace comes to us because we are sinners in need of it. And the God we worship is good, who answers our need even before we ask. We know that those who sin more get more grace because they need to be forgiven more. But even though we know that the kingdom works this way, does this mean that we should sin more so that we get more grace? Absolutely not. Because there's more to baptism than just the forgiveness of sins. There's the forgiveness of sins there, absolutely. But the God we worship always gives more. In baptism, we are claimed. We are washed of that old Adam, that old sinful tendency, so that we are no longer our own. Instead, we are purchased. We belong to God Almighty. And Jesus sees us, and He knows us as God's children. And that's what is most important. He sees us, and He knows us as God's children. This reality invites us to look into the world in which we live differently than those around us. It calls us to crucify the things we know from God's Word as sin and separate ourselves from them. It invites us to love our neighbor actively because we've been made into ambassadors of the Most High in the world in which we live. We've had our heart of stone replaced with a heart of flesh that can love. Baptism brings us that new identity with the forgiveness of our sins, and Jesus knows us. And that's what's most important. So we cling to our baptism. We cling to the promises that come with it. We wear the righteousness of Christ as a garment, as the scriptures say. We're cleansed and baptized into his death and resurrection. His sacrifice is our sacrifice. His righteousness is our righteousness. And as St. Paul says, if we are united with him in a death like his, and we certainly are, we will also be united with him in a resurrection like his. And so as we begin this new season of Epiphany, as we begin this new year, we do so with the knowledge that we are known by God and we have his presence with us wherever we go, whatever we are doing. And that's what's most important. For with him comes a peace that passes human understanding. It guards our hearts and our minds in him until the day of his return. May God grant it in this new year. And in every year moving forward. Amen. As we continue in our worship this morning, we've already done the Apostles' Creed. We did that kind of in the first part as we remembered our baptism. So at this time, we worship God with our tithes and our offerings. Lord God, our Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise for this new year, for the opportunity to worship you as your children, sons and daughters. We give you thanks and praise for you know us better than we could know anything. You know our needs even before we ask. You open your hand and you satisfy the desires of every living thing. And as we worship you with our tithes and our offerings, Lord, we ask that what we bring will be pleasing in your sight. Use them to accomplish your good and gracious will in the world in which we live. All to your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends in Christ, let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord of all creation, you spoke creation into being, beginning with light. In this Epiphany season, in all our days, grant us faith to see the light of your providing hand, the guidance of the light of your word, and our Savior as the light of the world. Help us to shine your light of truth and grace into this dark world, that others may know you and rejoice in your name. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of all grace, though our many sins and shortcomings weigh heavy on our hearts, you come to us in your means of grace and give new life. Help us to daily remember our baptism and to daily rejoice in our identity as your own children and part of your family. With Christ as the head, bless this family of believers within your church, that through worship and fellowship, all may be blessed with encouragement, support, service, and zeal for growing and sharing your word. Bless all families and homes, that parents and children may remain steadfast in faith, trusting in you above all things. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of all comfort, following the baptism of Jesus, he would seek the lost, heal the sick, and show compassion to all. Enable us in boldness and confidence to proclaim the wonders of him who has called us out of darkness and into your marvelous lights. Use our words and our actions to be a blessing to others. For those who are sick and suffering, grant your continued presence and healing according to your will. We remember especially this week those that are on our 516 list and those who have been hospitalized and are recovering from surgery and those who are battling long-term illness, those that we name especially on our hearts. Grant patience in trials, peace in afflictions, and hope in your promises now and eternally. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us rise for the preface. And if you're using your hymnal, that begins on page 177. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created. You sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and in the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and your spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples to eat, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to all of them to drink, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen. Amen.
Come, Lord Jesus.
O Lord Jesus Christ, you're the only Son of the Father. In giving us your body and your blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and to confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Thank you.
Eyes for prayer. Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us once again through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same, in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
We close our worship in song, All Who Believe and Are Baptized.
Thank you.
congregation, please be seated. A few things before we go forth this morning. Number one, we're getting back into the saddle this week. All of our Bible classes and things are resuming, so make sure you pick up the announcements and know what's going on and where that stuff is. Giving envelopes can be picked up in the narthex if you haven't picked those up yet. Smitty would love it if you would. So there's that. Bible classes resume today. Pastor Anderson's ready to go. And all of that stuff is going on. Let's see. What's that? Oh, Dennis is doing his as well at 9:30 up there in room 25. Yeah? I always get that confused. Is that 25 or 26? 25. It's in 25. You guys know where it's at. You know where it's at. Okay. Slides. What do we got for slides? There's a healthy living class that's going to start in February. February 1st through March 21st. There are 8 classes. It's a matter of balance, managing concerns about falls, some exercise you can do to kind of keep your balance. Sherry's going to lead that in room 23. So please give us a call and let us know that you plan to come because there's limited space up there. We got a lot of space in room 23, but it's not infinite. So please let us know. All right? And that's it. That's it. That's all we got. Happy New Year!
Happy New Year!
Go in peace.
Serve the Lord with gladness.
Thanks be to God. Grab some coffee and donuts next door. Wreck that New Year's resolution. Just get it done. Have a great week in Christ.